Hi, morning, John here. This is a video on our 2024 house usage, sort of performance if you like, covering solar, batteries, costs, the whole nine yards. So I'm going to jump straight into it, do a little bit of a review, because quite a lot happened throughout the year, which I haven't documented in video format. I've been too busy doing other things, so apologies for that. However, I do intend to pick up on some of the things in more detail that I'm talking about here. Been a very mixed year in terms of weather. Some photos here showing you some of the various conditions that we experienced, as did everyone else. One of the major changes we had this year was in May, we had a second Powerwall 2 installed and a Gateway 2. Previously, we had one Powerwall and the old-fashioned Gateway 1. So the Gateway 2 allows us to be off-grid in the event of a power cut, and we've already had a couple of those, so that's been useful. But the main reason was to getting the two Powerwalls was because since we had the air source heat pump fitted in 2024, the electricity usage has gone up considerably, and we were finding we didn't have enough battery storage to allow us to run through the day on cheap electricity. We would then run out and we'd end up pulling from the grid at peak times. So a second Powerwall was a requirement there. We had some phenomenal aurora in May. So May was a busy month, actually. So a few shots there out of our back garden. June was typical nice June weather. Or at least those two photographs of it are. Other work we had done, which is not specifically down to renewables, but I thought I'd show you anyway. Garage doors, these are our old garage doors. We had two garage doors, a separate garage, not attached to the house. And as you see, there's a central brick column and two electric roller shutter doors. And there's two things I wanted doing. One is I have this ramp here, this vehicle ramp, pneumatic vehicle ramp, which sits on the ground. And the problem with that is you can probably see there on that photo is that you have to roll the car on and over it each time. And it means you can only put the car in one place because you can't park it anywhere else. So I wanted the ramp sunk into a small pit, which involved protecting the garage in the first place because of all the concrete dust. So it looked like some kind of crime scene once I'd put up all of the dust sheets there. And then I had a local builder friend who came and chopped out all of the base, did a really neat job actually, and the base chopped out, mixed up loads of concrete, put in wire mesh. There's a done proper job on this because we were worried about the structural strength of the floor, based that we're having a car ramp on there with 1.5 to 2 tons of car on top of it. We wanted to make sure that it didn't collapse under the weight. So he's dug down extra deep. Fill that in. You'll see all the little posts around the side there for a later addition, which is the edges, which is filled in there. So detail, close shot of it. And then this is the finished thing. It took three of us to lift the ramp back into position. That was a bit of a challenge. We managed it. Two trolley jacks wheeling it in. And then I cut some boards to cover it, so I can now park anywhere in the garage. So that was a major improvement. The only downside to that was that with the garage being as it was, with the central pillar, you couldn't manoeuvre the car very well. So we also went with having the central pillar removed and a new I-beam put in. It's going in. And then we had a new garage door installed, single width roller door. So that was impressive. That was good. In July, we upgraded our internet. So we're now full fiber to the house. And that's a typical speed there, 580 megabits per second with a 56 upload. July was another busy month, actually. We had air-to-air units fitted by Mark, who did our air source heat pump. So you can see their big pallet arrived. So it's two brown boxes at the bottom are the outdoor units, and then the cassettes or indoor units are the four on top. So we had two in the house and one in each of one of our studios, one in the photography studio, one in the glass studio. And the two indoor units, one went in the dining room and one went in the bedroom. And I've got to say, one of the best things we have done. We certainly used them in the summer last year when it was very hot, air conditioning. And we've used the ones in the studio more. This is the house one. This is the larger unit of the two. This is them being installed, hence all the stickers still on them. So that's the bedroom one. And then this is the one in the dining room. So the dining room is, the outdoor unit is quite big. And this is the small unit, which is behind one of the studios. And this is the trunking joining the two studios. This is it from the other perspective, looking back to the unit, just tucked around the corner there. They've done a very neat job on the install, I've got to say. And this is the condense pipe water overflow, so we've got no problems with the units filling up the little reservoir inside. They all externally vent any extra moisture created. This is the one in the studio, and in the studio units the guys fitted a power switch underneath. You see an on-off and few spur switch there, which they said they tend to do in commercial situations where you can turn it off if you needed to. Rather than turn off the whole unit, you can just isolate the head, as it were, or the cassette. There's the remote. It's fairly straightforward. We've also got an app, as you would expect nowadays, which again, is straightforward. And I've also dropped them into Home Assistant as well, so we can control them via automations if we want to. We don't currently, but we can also do that if we want to. I have various types of weather. This is September, believe it or not. We had a frost in September, our first morning frost. Other things in September, we installed via Open Energy Monitoring a new device which they just created, which allows us to monitor the hot water. Previously with the Open Energy Monitoring, the monitoring did everything, so it monitored the whole usage of the air source heat pump. So in terms of what electricity it used, how much heat it output to work out the coefficient of performance. But we couldn't separate how efficient the hot water was from the heating. So this little device does that. It measures the three-port valve. And that then allowed us to be able to monitor the hot water. So I say this is from September onwards. So just taking one example here. When was this? Oh, 31st of December, almost the end of the year. Well, it is the end of the year. And you can see there in the top left-hand corner, it says all. So that's the performance of everything on that day. So a COP of 5 with electric usage of 15 kilowatt hours, heat of 76 kilowatts of heat produced, and 9.5 outside temperature. And that also includes our hot water. But now we can click on the little hot water icon, which is the fourth one along on the top left hand menu there. And for the same day, it shows us that our hot water performance COP was 3.46. So that's very useful now to be able to separate that data. Into October, some great weather, some lovely sunsets and sunrises. We had a bit of a problem with the Zoe, unfortunately. It had its annual service. A couple of days after that, it then developed a fault. And I'm not saying that it had a result of the service, it had nothing to do with it. It was just a coincidence. We got this error message on the dashboard, which typically is the 12-volt battery. I checked the battery and it was okay. The fault still was there, and it turned out after diagnostics from Cleveley Motors that the DC-DC unit had failed. I arranged for the car to be sent to Cleveley in Cheltenham for them to replace it. It's a 10-hour job to pull out all of the front bumper, undo all of the peripherals and get to the motor, because the DC-DC unit's on top of the motor, apparently. So that was quite expensive. Came out at an £1,800 bill. And because it was down with Cleveley for a while, we needed a second car. So we decided to get a second Tesla, and we ordered a Model 3, so a second-hand one. And this is the standard range plus. So it's our sort of local daily runabout, and we're really pleased with this. We had snow in November, which was interesting. update in November also to the Vaillant air source heat pump, which allowed us to change the heat curve. You can do that in the app. And this was end of November. Lots of frost. So I also took the opportunity when it was really a cold snap to balance the radiators. So I printed out a schematic of our radiators and went around with a heat gun or temperature gun and measured the input and output of each radiator, and found that the upstairs radiators were a lot hotter than they needed to be. Once I'd gone around and done all that on the upstairs radiators, took off the little cap, and on the lock shield I tightened it down fully and then released it by about a quarter of a turn, just to reduce the flow through the radiator so it pushed heat through the rest of the radiator, the rest of the system. And that worked extremely well. So the system may not be perfectly balanced, but it's a lot better than it previously was. So downstairs is a lot warmer now. Let's have a look at some stats. So Ripple, start with them. So that's the year to date. Well, so since beginning, actually, not year to date. So since March 2022 with Craig Pfaffer, and then Kirk Hill coming online in June of 2024. So far, cumulative savings from Ripple is £1,700, as I say there. That's 23% of our total investment of just under £8,000 across 34 months. The normal charts here, I'm not going to spend too much time on these, so pause these if you want to look at these in a little bit more detail. I've got some totals as well, which I'll show you in a minute. December, finishing off the year of 117 kilowatt hours for the month. And then there's a combined total of our two arrays, the 2.34 and the 4 kilowatt. This is the Powerwall and solar percentage to our self-powered. A lot of people were saying December was dismal for them, so I thought I'd bring up this one. This covers our solar PV production since 2011. And you can see here the last December in 2024 was 117. So it's low, but it's certainly not the worst. December 2015 was slightly below, as was 2021. A little bit down, but not horrendously down. These are our yearly totals over the last few years from 2019. So you've got solar in yellow, battery in the next column, battery out in the green, from the grid in red, and to the grid in the final column with your totals there. And you can clearly see in 2024 we've got a massive increase in electricity usage. This is our breakdown of that data, looking at again the same years, 2019 through to 2024, in a different slice of the same data set. Home usage, solar generation, from the Powerwall to the Powerwall, from the grid and to the grid. It was nice to see a very little figure, very low figure for to the grid. Those that are familiar with our setup will know that we don't have an export tariff. We generally use everything that we produce on site. So as you can see there, 160 to the grid is very little. This is our average daily house usage, month by month. The blue line is home usage, average home usage, and the red is what we pulled from the grid. This is monthly sent to the grid. And this is from the grid. This is our annual solar production year on year. So a little bit down this year, 2024 versus 2023, by 400 kilowatts even. 400 watts would be nice, wouldn't it? These are our FIT payments over the years. We're on the, a lot of people term as the golden FIT, because we had our solar panels installed in 2011, our 4 kilowatt array. We benefit from the original FIT scheme payment, which is quite generous, as you'll see in a minute when we look at the summary slide. So there's our annual payment, 2008, at almost £2,900 for the year. This is the quarterly breakdown, again year by year, if you're interested in seeing that. This is 12 months with the air source heat pump. Quite difficult to see what's going on there. Just having a look at that. But you can see the key at the top there, domestic hot water. You'll start to see that from September onwards. Flow and returns in green, outside temperature, heat and electricity. Tricky to see, so here's the summary of that data for that same time period. So the COP, or seasonal performance factor, is 4.2, rounded up to one decimal place. And you can see there the electrical consumption, 3,000 kilowatt hours used, and generated 13,000 kilowatts of heat. Flow temperature, the mean flow temperature was 25. This is taken in my own spreadsheet, but it's the same sort of data really. The difference is between Vaillant say and what Open Energy Monitoring, or OEM. OEM is a lot more accurate because it's an industry spec heat meter, so it is accurate. The Vaillant is a bit more optimistic, 4.4. Here are our 2024 summary. So electric bill came in at £1,040 for the year. Breaking that down, we had 10,000 kilowatt hours at off peak and 300 at peak. We averaged 97% of our electricity was off peak, and gave us an average unit rate of 7 pence per kilowatt hour. And certainly solar and the additional battery pack helped with that. FIT payments came in at 2,800. And I mentioned earlier on, we were on the golden FIT, so we are on 71 or 72 pence per kilowatt hour. And we also have deemed export of 5 pence, which is calculated at half our generation total. Ripple payments of £611 for the year, which brought us a surplus of £2,460. And as I've said before, though, that surplus is ploughed back into, you know, things like the air-to-air units and the second battery. So over time, we all plough it back in to improving the home. So there you go. That's our year-end summary. As I said, I will do separate videos on the install for the Powerwall 2 and also for the installs for the air-to-air units. If there's anything else, any questions, drop them down below and I shall pick them up. So thanks for watching. See you again. Take care.